mom and dad were here last week, and we started talking about baptisms and which ones there are according to Scripture. So basically, we just talked about there are four different types of baptism in Scripture. There's John's baptism, which is the baptism of repentance. Okay, and then there's the baptism by the disciples and Jesus Christ, which is water baptism, which we'll see today. There's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and then there's the baptism of suffering. So there are basically four types of baptism that the scriptures talk about, and we went over John's baptism last week, and we started talking about water baptism. And we didn't get to the end of it because we got into pretty good discussion. So, like I said, you guys can go on the YouTube under CITWC-BB. I know there's a lot of letters in there. CITWC-BB, which stands for Burton. That's the kind of class we're at. BB, yes. So on the tail end of things where we left off, I just wanted to start my slideshow here. And that is how to administer water baptism. We'll be seeing some of that today. First, we know that one must repent of their sins. Peter said in Acts chapter 2, 38, that repent, believe, and be baptized. And he's giving the process, the order, what it took to be baptized. Here we are. Repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. He was basically saying, here's the order. Repent and be baptized. Some other parts, I think, is repent, believe, and be baptized. It's the repent process of the belief. One must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Mark 15:16. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. One must have a good conscience for God. 1 Peter 3:21. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also, not the removal of dirt from the body, but a clear conscience for God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When should we be baptized as a new believer? As soon as they become a new convert. Now, this is according to Scripture. There are only a few scriptures that talk about when they came and repented, and then what happened after that. So we see Acts 22:16, Acts 16:32-33, Acts 18:8, and Acts 19:4-5. You can write those scriptures down and take a look at them later. You can go back to the video once it's up on Tuesday and do it again. But these are the scriptures that pertain to when. Because in scripture, basically, when they gave their life to the Lord and they turned to Him, when they repented and turned to God, the first thing they did was look for a place to be baptized. So basically, as soon as we have the opportunity, nowadays, what Western civilization has really made it to be, and I'm not saying it's a completely negative thing, but it's almost been developed as a system. Today we have a baptistry in the church that we fill up, right? And so we schedule it, and you know, it could be 1, 2, 3 months down the road, maybe. You know, we try and figure out, well, what's the schedule look like? Not just us, but churches in general, right? And then they will have kind of an event. Well, basically, it's really just a lifestyle of living that, I mean, I know my dad used to tell me stories back in the day when people gave their life to the Lord. I mean, they cut holes in ponds, because it was the nearest, closest place to be submerged around where they were at. And so they would, you know, dive in cold water and be baptized. Even bathtubs. You know, bathtubs are a very popular place to be baptized. Anywhere where you can be submerged. If we talk about understanding baptism, or the word bapto, the root of it, means to dip or to be whelmed, to be completely overtaken. Right? It even talks about the Greek word baptizo, because baptize is not an English word. Baptize is a alphabet, simply by removing the E or removing the O and adding the E. And now it now becomes a transitive verb, to baptize. Simply by removing the O, the baptizo, which literally means to dip or take in the likeness of the substance. So maybe consider it like a dye. When you dip something into a dye and you pull it out, now whatever has been pulled out and whatever has went in has taken on the likeness from the dye. Does that make sense? And so that's what it's referring to. When you are being baptized, you are taking on the likeness, right? So she will be baptized into water, but she's being baptized into Jesus Christ. So this morning, she's going to take part into a death, burial, and resurrection, because that's what water baptism stands for. And so it's nothing more than an outward seal on what has already happened inwardly. There's a process that is taking place in Devon that is happening inwardly that now the Lord wants to see outwardly sealed. You don't get baptized and then believe. You repent, believe, and then you get baptized. And so this is the process that we're going to see today with a couple of people. Yeah, sir. So super excited for that. How? By immersion. Acts 8:38, and in the name of Jesus, in Matthew 28:19, that's, I can tell you there offhand, the Great Commission that we've all probably heard. It says, go into all the nations and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So even this morning, we're going to baptize in the name of Jesus, because that's by whom we baptize by. So now we're going on to Christian baptism part two, because I broke it up into two sections last week. There were two sections of baptism. One section is John's baptism. That's one whole section. John's baptism was basically get ready to change your life. Get ready to not live like you used to live, because there is one coming after me who will baptize you in the Holy Spirit and fire. And so John's baptism didn't really relieve the sin in people's lives. Only the baptism of Jesus Christ could relieve the sin, because that represents the death of the man, the death of the old self, the death of the sinful nature, the burial and the resurrection of a new being in Jesus Christ. So now we're talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And this has been a little tricky over time. It is really a touchy subject among the church today, between over 35,000 different Christian denominations in the house in the world. And it's just, a lot of people believe and understand and agree on God as the Father and Jesus as the Son. But for some reason, the Holy Spirit always seems to be the part where it's very touchy and very opinionated. And so that's why it's important that when we talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that we do it carefully, thoroughly, and strictly. That way I don't have my opinion on it. I have to go right to God's word like I do everything. So we see that in the Old Testament, it was declared, it talks about the latter rain. I didn't put it down because it's pretty long in verse, but you can look it up. And it's basically a prophecy talking about in the end times and in the latter days, there's going to be a latter rain poured out on people. And what Joel was prophesying about was the Holy Spirit coming. So that was the beginning understanding that God gave a word through Joel talking about in the latter days there's going to be a latter rain. There's going to be a fall of the Holy Spirit. Your daughters, your sons will prophesy. The men will dream dreams and have visions. Right? Which they reiterate in the New Testament scripture. John the Baptist declared it in Matthew 3:11. I baptize you with water for repentance. But one after me comes who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Jesus declared in Acts 1:5, for John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. This is obviously Jesus has come. Jesus has resurrected at this time, and he spent 40 days showing himself to the disciples, and I don't know if there were roughly maybe 500 people or so, I think, Galilee, we might have seen him, but preach on the kingdom of God again. He preached on it before he died. He rose, and he preached on it again, and he's saying, listen, I'm getting ready to go, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit when I leave. My the council will be coming. The apostles declared it in Acts 11:16. Then I remembered what the Lord had said. John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So the scriptures are kind of the same, but you see that there are three different types of people declaring. First John, who had to walk it out. Jesus, who had to follow up with the apostles, who now follow after Jesus and are witnessing what's going on and taking part in it. Acts 19:1-2, all apostles that were in Paul took the road to the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They answered, no, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. Now, here are seven New Testament references where baptism is used in connection with the Holy Spirit. And in these scriptures, you see baptized with the Holy Spirit. But in the Greek, what you see, as we talked about, baptized not being an English word, but being a Greek word translated by the English alphabet, so you can understand it. The Greek preposition, they don't use with. Okay? I baptize you with, I baptize you with. I baptize with. All of these withs in there are actually in the Greek preposition, I baptize you. The language they use was, I am baptizing you in the Holy Spirit. Which means now so there's a process, there's a spiritual process taking place of you going in the Holy Spirit. Being dipped in the Holy Spirit. Coming out, taking on the likeness of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit's personality and function. Okay?
Yeah,
there's
also an
information
on the Bible that comes in John.
I want to do this because last time I didn't really like what's going on.
In John, it's for the patient to say, you have the Holy Spirit has been with you, but soon it will be in you. Because he was talking about the Old Testament, he was brought on a purpose for a short period of time for a specific purpose.
Right.
And then it was gone. That's why in David says, he's not your Holy Spirit for me.
Have you been reading my notes?
No, actually, I'm out of the classroom. They get it.
Right, and that's the truth. even in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come upon people like Samson. And Samson's strength was taken from him when he disobeyed God in his prayer. But Samson had a process of repentance and turned back towards God and realized what he did wrong. And the Lord poured his spirit up. He put his spirit with him for a moment in time. And he had the strength to tear down the pillar. So a lot of times in the Old Testament, God would put his spirit on people, but it was for a moment in time. It wasn't permanent until Jesus left. And the Holy Spirit. That's very good. We'll even talk about that here. So the difference between the ascension of Jesus and after the ascension of Jesus, what I should have thought, is what she was talking about. Before the Holy Spirit was with the disciples in John 20:22, and with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now this was before this is before Jesus' death. So he breathed him, he said, receive the Holy Spirit, but yet the Holy Spirit was not going to be in them and upon them until he left and the Holy Spirit would come in permanent place. After the Holy Spirit was in and upon them, they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled the Holy Spirit and begin to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Acts 18, in the last days, God said, I will pour my Spirit on all people, your sons and This is the jolts that God will bring to you. Your old, your sons and daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servant, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit on them, and they will prophesy. At 9:17, when I went to the house and entered in, placing his hands on Saul, and he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Go ahead.
I wonder if you can go back to the authority of the right now.
Yes. You're okay. So it's really important that we understand what it means to have something come upon you and yet fill you. Okay? And I'm going to read a part of this book here in a second. This book is probably one of the most powerful books that I know of. And I've gotten a lot of my knowledge out of this book. It's called Foundational Truths for Christian Living by Derek Prince. And a lot of this study is out of this book. So, I mean, if any of you guys ever want a copy or want to borrow it, I have no problem lending it to you. Make sure you guys can get a copy somehow. Or I, yes, it is Foundational Truth for Christian Living by Derek Prince. But there is just some very deep, deep and simple truths when it comes to Christian living that, I mean, has just completely wowed me in my growing process. And that's the important part of this teaching is that it's they're elementary, not by childish, but by foundational, and they're so deep that anything else that comes our way that God desires to learn, we will take in and continue on to maturity. It's really amazing. Derek Prince. So we'll move forward here. Immersion and enveloping, taking on the personality of the Holy Spirit as a person. What many people don't realize is that the Holy Spirit is a person. And we don't acknowledge the Holy Spirit in our Christian lifestyle like we acknowledge Jesus and we acknowledge God. But the crucial thing is that they are all of the most important necessities. They are all one, yet they are all different. And that is just a mystery that some people try and explain using an egg, using an apple. You know, you got the shell, you got the egg white, you got the yolk, and those things aren't bad by any means because you try and have a visual picture. But none of them will ever really do it justice. It's just one of those amazing mysteries. And how someone can be three people yet. And so it's just pretty cool. So I'm going to read this book really quick that really explains it better than I ever could. And so whenever I have an opportunity to make it really crystal clear and more awesome, if that's a word, than I can, then I like to do that. So I'm going to read this book. It says, "Inwardly, the believer, in the likeness of one drinking, receives the presence and power of the Holy Spirit within himself until there comes a point at which the Holy Spirit thus receives. In turn, wells up within the believer and flows forth like a river from the inmost depths of his being. No human language can fully describe a mighty supernatural experience such as this, but it may perhaps be illuminated to borrow a picture from the Old Testament. In the days of Noah, the whole world was submerged beneath the flood." Now remember, I'm talking about the Spirit coming and filling you and coming upon you at the same time. It's one experience, but occasions in one experience. "So in the days of Noah, the whole world was submerged beneath the flood. In bringing about the flood, God used two distinct but complementary processes. In Genesis 7:11, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, on that day all the fountains of the great deep were broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. This account reveals that the waters of the flood came from two sources. From within, the foundations of the great deep were broken up, and from above, the windows of heaven were opened, and the rain was poured down. We must, of course, observe that the flood of Noah's day was a flood of divine wrath and judgment. The flood that immersed the New Testament believer is one of divine mercy, glory, and blessing. However, with this qualification, the New Testament believer who receives the fullness of the Holy Spirit exhibits the same two aspects as this in the account of the flood. From within, the fountains of the great deep within the believer's own personality are broken up, and there gushes out a mighty flood of blessing and power in most people. And from above, the windows of God's mercy are opened up on the believer, and there is poured out upon him such a deluge of glory and blessing that his whole personality is immersed. It must be emphasized that we are not speaking of two separate experiences, but rather of two distinct yet complementary aspects that together make up the fullness of one season. And I just thought, wow, how better can I can never explain it like that? That from the inner earth, God cracked it and the flood came, and yet poured upon the rain and the flood came. Right? So one experience was happening from two separate occasions, but yet it caused one experience. You know, and how he elaborated that from, you know, the Holy Spirit in the New Testament, how it pours upon us and yet fills us. Right? To the point where we spill out. That's the whole point of the Spirit of God in us, is that it spills out. Not that we hold on to it like a secret, but that everything in us pours out, and so people, it's just everything. So, I mean, I was just really wowed by that. Another aspect, if you think about even the ark, Noah's ark itself, right? The Bible says that it was filled outside and within with tar or pitch. That tar is a symbolism for atonement. Atonement was the process of Jesus taking away our sin. That's atonement. So if you think about that, I mean, just the illustrations that God uses, how he filled the inside of the ark and the outside with the tar to seal it. So on the outside it was sealed, on the inside it was sealed. Or even the Ark of the Covenant, which on the inside was sealed with gold and so it was on the outside. Which gold is a representation of God's glory. You see how those things work, how God operates? It's just absolutely amazing. So I just, that stuff just wowed me, so I wanted to share that with you. We'll see where I'm at. There's also a video I want to show you that is absolutely amazing that really understands the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So does one receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit at the time of conversion? Right? Now we know that at the time of conversion, the Holy Spirit dwells within man. When I receive Jesus Christ as my Savior and my Lord, and I repent and turn and walk towards him, he calls me a son. But I can't be his son without his Spirit. Well, that is how the adoption process begins. The scriptures talk about that we are predestined into adoption, that we are predestined into sonship. I believe that's an earlier teaching. But that was always God's plan. Us to be family. Right? So, we do have the dwelling of the Holy Spirit. But yet, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is a whole other experience that God offers. We see that the apostles didn't. In Acts 2:4, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. These were the apostles that were believers in Jesus Christ before he died and after. So they were already Christians. They were already disciples. They were already believers. But yet, they did not experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit until Pentecost. The rest of the 120 didn't. Who were they? When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly the sound of one of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came down to rest. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. The Samaritans did, Acts 8, 12 through 16, when the apostles of Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come on any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So, this is what Devin is going to experience this morning. Now, Devin still has the opportunity to experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is a bigger experience. Well, tell me though, if you might even have that. Right, at group, which is another topic of discussion, because there is a point in time when Cornelius' house did. The Ephesians also did. Okay? But at Cornelius' house, they did. Okay? So they had this experience where the baptism of the Holy Spirit was a later experience in all those occasions except for this one. In Acts 10:44, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all of them who heard the message. So it is normal for a believer to receive the baptism as a separate experience and conversion. But yet, it is still acceptable and possible for someone who is already a believer to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit even before they receive the baptism of the water. Bruce Jive, when he became a believer, he wasn't baptized in anything yet. But the Holy Spirit came upon him and he started speaking in tongues. So there are many different experiences, but on the normal occasion, it is a separate experience. By biblical standards, it's a separate experience. Okay. Evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Evidence of the Holy Spirit comes with the word manifestation. Manifestation is a simple word for appear. Basically, when something is manifesting itself, you see it clearly. Okay? Now, yet, one cannot see the Holy Spirit by its nature. By its nature, the Holy Spirit is invisible. Jesus compares the Holy Spirit to the wind. John 3:8, the wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. The wind is invisible, but the effects of the wind produced when blown can be seen and heard. Right? So let me ask you this. What are some effects that can be seen or heard from the wind? Rustling of leaves. The branches breaking. Dust from the street blowing. You know, all these things. Yet you cannot see the wind. When the wind is roaring, you see the effects of the wind. So it is with the Spirit. Does that make sense to everybody? Mm-hmm. Peter speaks of the same thing in Acts 10:33. Exalt the Holy Spirit and pour out what you now see. Paul speaks of his own ministry. 1 Corinthians 2:4, my message and my preaching were not with lies and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power. What he's saying is, it was the Spirit in me speaking and making an impact. Not with my own wisdom of words, my eloquent words, the words that I thought of that would sound right at the time, but the evidence that you can't see of the Spirit is now being manifested by it speaking through me, or him speaking through me. Sometimes when I preach and I study all these notes and things, and there's times the Holy Spirit leads me away from it and I just start sharing. It's not me, I didn't plan it, I didn't do anything, but the Holy Spirit just puts a deposit in me and I have to be obedient. And so he just gives me a deposit of words to say and I say them. It happens like that. I can't explain it, it just happens. You know, there's times they get frustrated because you spend all this time studying and think, okay, Lord, I appreciate that. And then he goes, you're not even going to do that. You know, but that's just him. That's what he does. 7. Now to each one, who's he speaking about? All of them. To every believer. Each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. Everyone has the ability to manifest the Holy Spirit in them. But the baptism of the Holy Spirit is what releases. People who just come to the Lord simply just by coming to the Lord and never experienced or understanding the baptism of the Holy Spirit, they don't have the revelation on what it means to pour out the Spirit. That's why it looks so foreign to so many. Because it's uncomfortable, it's not shared, it's put away because we don't want to experience that. And so we just use the rest of the Bible to say this is how we do things. But 2 Timothy 3:16 says all Scripture, not some, all is used for correcting, for teaching, for strengthening, for rebuking, to equip the believer. So we've seen over time a progression of religion that they take it out because it cannot be possible to be used for today. But yet we choose what is possible because it's easy. And not so crazy. But when you experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit and you receive everything God has for you, you now are being equipped with everything the Holy Spirit has to offer is pouring in you so that you can well up and you can pour it out. Yes. Yes. Yeah, no, you're on the right track, Mom. It is for us. When you receive the Lord, you receive His Spirit. When you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you receive the release.
Good.
That's right. That's a very good analogy. I like that. Very good. So yes, this has always been the way in the will of the Lord.
And I think if you want it, you feel it stirring inside.
Yes. Yes. It is, and we'll even talk about how to receive it, which is pretty simple. And everything requires faith. Everything requires faith when it comes to God. So let's continue. Tongues is the first sign of evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, I found someone better. I wrote this down. That group can explain baptism in tongues better than I can. And I want to go to it. It's going to take me a second, but it's just a short, it's a 10-minute video of understanding tongues and every aspect of tongues in the New Testament and what it's used for. So, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to step out of this for a second. I'm going to go to
Caleb, when you start it, put the microphone by the wherever the speaker is.
Okay, I think it's coming from here.
Okay.
That's how I did it last time.
Okay.
But I'll try because I have this remote here.
I'll monitor it. I'll let you know.
Okay. His name is John Bevere. He's got some really good stuff out there, stuff like the Bait of Satan that deals with defense and other different things, but just some really, really powerful and simple understanding.
Forward.
Okay. Here we go. So weird, sometimes it's slow down here. Server or something down here? I don't get it. The tar was a representation of its own.
It ain't gonna go, Caleb.
Huh?
It's not gonna go.
You'd be able to hear it. Okay.
Lost paper. Remember that question?
Pretty awesome, isn't it? Yeah. You know, he made a good point there when he talked about living in the river. And a lot of times people, you know, they can be filled with the Holy Spirit, but simply choose not to yield to the things that the Holy Spirit offers. When you simply yield to it, you just persist in it in the heart of God, just let things happen naturally by the supernatural. We get to experience all the things that the Holy Spirit has. So I just really thought that video was awesome because it just really summed up the whole understanding of tongues better than I ever could. So I always go back to that video just for more clarification, for teaching scripture. I just go back to that because I wanted to know more, a little more about it. So it's just really amazing. But the purpose of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for power. Power for your gifts and power to have authority. You know, as believers, we have authority, but when you have the filling and the dwelling and the operation of the Holy Spirit, there is a revelation of the ability that the Holy Spirit offers that are both. And so we just really practice that and know that we have the authority. You know, Jesus talked about greater things you will do when you're talking to the disciples. Now, there's nothing greater than raising the dead. There's nothing greater than the thing that he did, but he's saying your ministry by the numbers and the area you're going to cover is going to be far greater than I ever did. Because Jesus ministered for 3 years and he covered a certain amount of area. But he's saying more of you like me, more of you like-minded, and more of you like-spirited will have a greater impact in the world than I did. So he's saying greater things you will do. Your disciples. What an encouraging thing to hear. You know, when God, you're seeing Jesus do all in here, it is a greater thing to you. Because he understood what it took and the purpose and the destiny for man, even Jesus himself in his assignment, what it was to lay down your lives for God and for one another, and for those they don't know, to express the love of Jesus Christ. To witness. Be bold, fruitful, and to share the truth. These are the things that the baptism of the Holy Spirit really releases and gives you a revelation. Acts 1:4, on one occasion while he was eating with them, he gave this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised that you have heard me speak about. So he's saying, don't go anywhere now. Okay? In 1:8 he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. There is a key component here. Listen, don't go yet because you aren't fully equipped. Once the Spirit comes upon you and you are filled with my Spirit, you will be able to be ready to be released and what comes at you and you'll be ready for it because you will operate in power and you will be holy. Okay. Well, how do we receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? This is actually this is actually 1 and 2. Repent and be baptized. Right? Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. First, John 7:37-38. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow. So we repent, you get baptized, you start to thirst for the things of God. Ask, Luke 11:13, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who have? Drink. See, there's thirst and there's drink. Active process of receiving is what drink the first out of. Open wide your mouth. Yield. Just like John Deere talked in his message, yielding to the river. Surrender yourself to God. Romans 6:13. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as a instrument of witness, but rather offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer every part of yourself to Him as an instrument of witness. So, I tell you what, we are pretty much there at 10 o'clock. This is the baptism of suffering. We'll talk about this next week, and then we'll go into the laying on of hands. This one takes too long, but I do want to honor time. So, does anybody have any questions? Any comments?
I think this is about empowering yourself.
know, it's one of those things that the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter. But we have to understand that we have to do things that are uncomfortable to us so that we can rely on the Comforter of Him. And so when we operate through and by the Holy Spirit, we operate by His comfort alone. Because naturally, to human intellect and understanding, it's crazy, weird, and obscure. And, you know, well, God calls us aliens in this land. We are foreigners in this land. Because this is a temporal place for us, but we know that when He comes in His fullness, that we will reign with Him forever on a new earth with a new heaven on earth. That the heaven that we talk about now will pass away. He will get rid of it. Just like He will get rid of this earth, but He will create a new heaven on a new earth with us as His children. And He will be our light. Scripture says that the sun will be away, done away with the stars, everything, and He will be the light for us. I mean, what an awesome day that you think about. You know? So, yeah, I mean, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it is real, it is awesome. And it has to be comforting, because any other way is just completely, to us, it's uncomfortable, you know. So next week we'll discuss the baptism of suffering and what that means, and then we'll go right into the laying on of hands, okay? All right.